If you've ever wondered how PCMag tests laptops and desktop PCs, you're in the right place. We're going to give you an overview of the process that's been a core part of our PC Lab's routine since we started in 1984.
Our computer review process honors the traditions we established when PC Labs was founded, and it has continually evolved from there. We compare every system we review based on price, features, design, and most importantly, performance.
Performance is a big part of what you pay for in a PC, and to evaluate it, we use a variety of benchmark tests. Some are specialized software, and some are real-world applications using test procedures we've developed ourselves. For a given computer, we test the processor, the memory, the storage, the graphics, and more. Doing that helps us quantify and highlight each system's strengths and weaknesses.
With our latest revision to our benchmark suite, we've taken it a step further by testing PCs' neural processing engines, also known as NPUs. So how do we test laptops and desktops? We have a few ground rules that we follow with all systems. We only review fully production-ready units with the latest updates and drivers, so we're always providing the most accurate and up-to-date experiences at the time we receive the machine.
All right, now let's dive into how we test laptops and desktops for productivity. That includes everything from how well the PC runs word processing and spreadsheet programs to how well it works with editing and rendering media files.
We cover a wide range of real-world use cases like writing, editing, managing data, and even multimedia communication. This is where we really put the PCs to the test to ensure that they can handle the tasks people tend to do every day, not just the graphically intense stuff or the professional-level workloads.
Let's start with our first benchmark test, PC Mark 10 from Underwriters Labs, or UL. This is one of the most important tests that we run. It simulates everyday office tasks, like word processing, web browsing, video conferencing, and spreadsheet analysis. It does this via traces, or simulated tasks that stress the system in the same way that a Microsoft Word document, or a Zoom call, or a web browser would.
We use the full version of PCMag 10, which gives us a single performance score. These scores can vary by a lot depending on the specific hardware configurations of the PC being tested. Systems scoring over 4,000 or 5,000 points are considered excellent for typical productivity tasks like those in the Microsoft Office or Google Workspace.
Now, PCMark is not just about us comparing laptops and desktops to each other. Larger organizations also use PCMark 10 to decide if new hardware is a good fit for their users' workloads compared to the systems that they already have.
Next, we test storage with PCMark 10's full system drive storage test. This test evaluates how fast a laptop's drive responds, important from everything from boot up times to program load speeds. Higher scores here mean quicker access to files and faster startup times. Like the regular PCMark 10 test, you get a single score that can be used for comparison between systems, and higher is better.
Now, these results factor into everything from hard drives to basic serial ATA SSDs to higher-end PCI Express SSDs. It's a great way to measure real-world differences between different types of storage solutions.
Next up is Cinebench 2024. This is a fully processor-focused benchmark. It uses software from Maxon running on an engine called Redshift to render a complex scene using either the CPU or GPU. We run the CPU version of Cinebench to really see how well a system handles multi-core and single-core processing.
The multi-core test is the more important one here. It scales with the number of cores and supported threads that a processor has, so more powerful CPUs will naturally score higher. The test is great for showing how well a laptop or desktop can handle demanding tasks like 3D rendering or computer-aided design. If the system cannot handle the heat generated at full load, though, it'll throttle back and you'll see a lower score. In this way, Cinebench can show you how a CPU works under full stress in a specific machine.
Then, we have Geekbench 6.3 Pro, another processor-focused test. This one's a bit like PCMark 10 in that it simulates a bunch of real-world applications, but here it's things like PDF rendering, speech recognition, and even machine learning. What's nice about Geekbench is that it's available for many different platforms, so we can easily compare Windows, macOS, and even Qualcomm Snapdragon ARM devices.
Like Cinebench, higher Geekbench scores indicate better performance, whether you're running a single-core task or a multi-core task. We report both types.
Finally, we test the video rendering performance with the very popular freeware program, Handbrake 1.8. Video rendering is one of the most CPU-intensive tasks out there, so like with the Cinebench multi-core test, this is where the real power of a laptop's processor gets tested.
So in Handbrake, we encode a 12-minute 4K video into 1080p format, a short movie called Tears of Steel.
Why don't you just admit that you're freaked out by my robot hand?
And we measure how long it takes. Faster times mean better performance. This test also scales very well with more CPU cores and threads, so again, systems with higher-end processors and adequate cooling systems will naturally perform better.
Another nice thing about this test, like Cinebench 2024 and Geekbench, Handbrake is compatible across platforms, x86, Windows on ARM, and Apple Silicon, so we can easily compare Windows and Mac systems directly.
So that's a rundown of our productivity testing. It's all about making sure that a system you're looking at can handle everyday tasks and more demanding workloads, from office work to video manipulation. Now that we've covered productivity, let's shift gears to content creation, where things get a little more intense.
Our content creation testing overlaps a little with our general productivity testing, but this class of tests consists of the kinds of programs you would use on machines that have discrete graphics chips, laptops and desktops built for heavy lifting tasks like photo editing, video production, and rendering.
Let's start with Adobe Photoshop 2024 Creative Cloud. Everyone knows the Photoshop photo editor. We use a third-party tool called Puget Bench for Creators from workstation maker Puget Systems that manipulates Photoshop the same way every time to test how a system handles photo editing tasks. It runs the system through a bunch of real-world uses like resizing images, applying filters, and more advanced operations like blurring and adding shadows.
Puget Bench also tests some of Photoshop's AI features like subject selection and content-aware fill. All these really stress both the CPU and the GPU, as well as memory and storage, giving us a clear picture of how a system holistically handles heavy image editing work.
At the end of the run, Puget Bench kicks us back a final score. Higher numbers here mean the system is faster and more efficient at handling creative workflows in Photoshop. And what's great, we could test with both Windows and macOS systems with this same benchmark and compare them directly.
For more advanced content creation systems and workstations, we also test using Adobe's Premiere Pro 24, which is one of the industry standards for video editing. Again, we use the Puget Bench for Creators extension to drive the system through a slate of real-world video tasks. These include live playback, file export, and encoding at 4K and 8K resolutions.
The Puget Bench workload in Premiere also stresses the GPU with special effects and other demanding tasks to really show how well a system can handle video production at the highest level. Just like with Photoshop, higher Puget Bench scores indicate better performance.
Also, with only the high-end systems, we run a test with the popular DaVinci Resolve Studio 18.6.6, another powerful video editor used for color grading and post-production work. This test again uses a Puget Bench for Creators extension to push both the CPU and the GPU with a range of video codecs, GPU effects, and even AI-powered features.
Now, DaVinci Resolve is particularly challenging for systems, so this test really helps us see which laptops, desktops, and workstations are ready for professional-level video production.
Finally, we test with Blender 4.2. Blender is a popular open-source 3D content creation tool used for modeling, animation, and rendering. We run the standalone Blender benchmark to measure how well the system handles different types of 3D rendering tasks.
The benchmark runs three different scenes called Monster, Junk Shop, and Classroom to test both CPU and GPU performance. We then get a final score based on how many samples the system can render per minute. Higher scores here mean the system is faster at rendering complex 3D scenes. Now that we've covered productivity and content creation, let's talk about another key aspect of laptop and desktop performance, graphics.
Graphics power is essential for everything from PC gaming to how smoothly apps run on your screen. Whether the system relies on integrated graphics or a powerful discrete GPU, we use a few key testing tools to put those graphics capabilities to the test.
First up, we use 3DMark, also from UL like PCMark is. 3DMark is one of the most widely recognized graphics test suites. It has different benchmarks in it designed for various GPU functions and software APIs like DirectX 12, Vulkan, and Metal.
We start with 3DMark Steel Nomad and Steel Nomad Lite. These two benchmarks are designed to test graphics performance on different platforms. Steel Nomad's built for high-end gaming setups running visually rich scenes at 4K resolution.
And then there's Steel Nomad Lite, which, as the name suggests, is a less demanding version. It's more accessible for less powerful devices rendering at 1440p and simplifying some of the more advanced graphics techniques. So if you're looking at a mid-range or lower-end PC, this is the more meaningful score to compare.
Next, we move to 3DMark Wildlife and Wildlife Extreme. These are our go-to cross-platform graphics tests for comparing performance between Windows and macOS systems.
Wildlife runs at 1440p, while Wildlife Extreme is the more challenging of the two. It renders at 4K and adds more geometry and particle effects to really push the system's limits. UL estimates that Wildlife Extreme is about three times more demanding than the standard Wildlife test.
Then we have 3DMark Solar Bay, which is all about ray tracing, one of the most advanced real-time lighting techniques used in gaming and content creation. While ray tracing usually requires a powerful gaming PC, Solar Bay also tests this feature on more lightweight devices like laptops and tablets.
This test runs on Vulkan 1.1 for Windows and Android devices and Metal for Apple devices. It puts 3D scenes through increasingly intense ray-traced workloads at 1440p resolution. It's a great way to see how even more portable devices handle this demanding graphics technology.
All of these tests deliver a proprietary 3DMark score, and higher is always better. The numbers are primarily meaningful only when compared to one another. So, whether you're gaming, editing, or just multitasking with a bunch of apps open, these tests really help us figure out, in a relative sense, how well the system's graphics can handle all of it.
Now that we've talked about productivity, content creation, and graphics testing, it's time to dive into the fun part of our testing, PC gaming.
These synthetic benchmarks we talked about before give us a general idea of graphics performance, but nothing quite compares to real-world game testing. So we selected three games from different genres to put gaming laptops and desktops to the test. These are machines with discrete graphics chips, and we only run these demanding games on these machines.
So first up, we test across three major genres: a sports racing simulation, a big-budget AAA open-world title, and a hyper-popular multiplayer first-person shooter. These games stress your hardware in different ways, giving us a comprehensive look at gaming performance.
All three of these games have built-in benchmark tools that run a consistent scene or gameplay snippet so we can get an accurate frame rate result measured in frames per second that are repeatable.
Since laptop screens and desktop monitors come in so many different sizes and resolutions these days, we have to account for that too. For example, we test these games on laptops at 1080p Full HD and at 1440p QHD, or the equivalent 16x10 resolution.
And we don't test just once. We run each game test at two different graphics settings, pushing the system through its paces with low and high graphical demands.
So let's start with the game F1 2024, which is our representative sports and racing sim. This game mixes realistic visuals with fast frame rates, and in racing sims, those high frame rates are crucial for smooth gameplay.
This is also why F1 2024 is ideal for testing frame rate boosting technologies like DLSS on NVIDIA systems or FSR on AMD systems. We run the built-in benchmark first with these technologies turned off, which one depends on the brand of the GPU installed, and then again with them active. These upscaling technologies help increase frame rates, and they are especially useful in systems with less powerful GPUs.
Next, we have Cyberpunk 2077. And if you're a gamer, you've probably heard of it. It's a huge AAA title that's all about pushing graphics to the limit. It's kind of the modern-day equivalent of Can It Run Crysis? This game renders detailed character models, advanced lighting, and a huge open-world environment.
Yeah, this game is a beast. We test it on the Ultra preset first, then we kick it up a notch with the Ray Tracing Overdrive preset, all without DLSS or FSR. It's one of the most demanding setups out there, perfect for showing how a system handles cutting-edge visuals.
Finally, we test Call of Duty Modern Warfare 3, which represents the competitive multiplayer shooter genre. In games like these, frame rate is everything. Competitive players want the smoothest gameplay possible.
That's right. In Call of Duty, we tested both the minimum and extreme graphics presets. Many competitive players prefer the lowest settings to maximize frame rates, so we want to see how the system performs at both the high and low settings. AI is an area that's rapidly evolving, and how laptops and desktops handle it is becoming more important. But testing AI is a whole new ballgame for us and for the industry at large. It's a work in progress.
AI is still in its early stages, so our testing approach will be constantly evolving to keep pace with the technology. We're continuously updating and improving our AI benchmarks to make sure they accurately reflect current advancements.
So here's a word of caution. AI benchmarking is still a young field, and comparing AI performance across different platforms like Intel versus AMD or Apple versus Qualcomm can be misleading. And as the technology advances, we'll keep updating our tests to ensure they stay relevant.
We have Geekbench AI, which is the evolution of Geekbench's earlier machine learning test called Geekbench ML, but it focuses more on large, real-world datasets that simulate practical AI tasks.
Exactly, and it tests each platform with the AI frameworks that are comparable with the system's components like ONNX, OpenVINO, QNN for Snapdragon X, and CoreML for Apple. The results are specific to the hardware and framework, so cross-platform comparisons need to be approached cautiously.
The other thing to bear in mind here is that a lot of AI tasks are done in the background, so that measuring them in a benchmarking sense isn't really what they're all about. So ultimately, some of the AI functionality of your system basically may come down to whether it works or whether it doesn't. Now that we've covered performance, content creation, graphics, and AI, let's dive into two crucial aspects that matter mostly for laptops: battery life and display quality. First up, let's talk about battery life. We all know how much battery life can vary depending on what you're doing: web browsing, gaming, or just writing emails.
Exactly. Some laptops will last many hours on a given task, but others might barely make it through the day under the same conditions. We aim for a fair, consistent test across all types of devices.
Now, for our battery test, we play a locally stored 720p video, which is the open source movie Tears of Steel, on a loop. We set the display brightness to 50% and the audio volume to 100% to keep things consistent.
We make sure each laptop is fully charged and the Wi-Fi as well as the keyboard backlighting is turned off. Then we set Windows 11 to a better battery power profile, not the peak performance setting.
When the battery reaches 5%, we instruct the system to hibernate. That's how we get a true sense of how long each laptop lasts under typical video playback conditions, without any external factors skewing the results. But bear in mind that if you're gaming or doing heavy rendering work or even nonstop web browsing, you're certainly going to get shorter battery life than we do in this test, probably much shorter depending on how demanding your tasks are. Our test is designed to show a battery maximum potential, but how everyone uses their laptop is different. So just take it as a yardstick for comparison, not an absolute number.
A laptop's display is one of the most important aspects, whether it's working on creative projects or just enjoying media.
So how do we measure that? We use DataColor's SpiderX Elite Colorimeter, which is a little device we keep around the lab. It helps us measure both brightness and color coverage, or the color gamut, on each laptop screen.
We start by using the SpiderX Elite to measure the brightness at two different levels, 50% and 100% brightness. The results are reported in nits, the standard brightness unit, which is also called candelas per square meter.
Now, the meter examines a series of test panels that the software pops up on screen. We also look at the screen's color gamut, which is how broadly and fully the screen can display a range of colors. We test, in doing that, the three most important color spaces, which are known as sRGB, Adobe RGB, and DCI P3.
Now, sRGB is the standard color space for web use and most applications. It's what photographers will use when editing photos for the web.
Then there's Adobe RGB, which covers a wider color gamut and is often used for printing high-quality images. If you're a photographer or graphic designer, you want to pay attention to this one.
And for those working in video, DCI P3 is the go-to color space. It's used in film production and digital cinema, so if you're editing or viewing movies, you want a display that can handle this color space well.
The color space measurements are given as a percentage of the colors that the display can show that comprise that particular color gamut. We use these measurements to see how well each laptop's display holds up under different scenarios. Whether you're working on photos and videos or just watching movies, these benchmarks tell you how effective that screen really is versus its competitors. Now that we've covered productivity, content creation, graphics, AI, battery testing, and display testing, let's talk about how we handle some special cases: Macs, Chromebooks, and workstations.
Computers today aren't just limited to Windows machines with Intel and AMD processors. We've got different hardware and software combinations that require some tweaking in our testing process. We try to keep things consistent at all times, but sometimes adjustments are necessary to accurately measure performance across these different platforms.
Let's start with Apple Macs. Since Macs run on macOS and the newest ones on Apple Silicon hardware, our testing here is slightly different from Windows systems. The biggest challenge is that we can't run PCMag 10 on macOS, so we miss out on those key productivity and storage scores.
But the good news is a lot of our other tests are cross-compatible. For example, we run Cinebench 2024, Handbrake, Geekbench, and Adobe Photoshop, all of which have native Mac versions. Premiere and DaVinci Resolve too, if the systems call for it. These tests let us directly compare Macs with Windows machines.
When it comes to graphics testing, some of the subtests of 3DMark are also cross-platform. But game testing, that's a totally different story. We try to keep the selection of games similar, but the specific games and tests can vary based on hardware and game support at the time.
Next, we have Chromebooks, which are pretty different from both Windows and Mac systems. Chrome OS is a browser-first platform, so testing Chromebooks requires a unique set of tools. We can't just run the same tests we use for Windows or Mac OS on Chromebooks.
For Chromebooks, we rely on Chrome-specific tests, like CrExpert 2 and Basemark Web. CrExpert 2 is useful for measuring how well a Chromebook handles common computing tasks like photo editing, finding faces in images, and calculating and graphing views of a stock portfolio.
And Basemark Web is all about how well a Chromebook can run browser-based apps. It tests everything from JavaScript performance to WebGL graphics, giving us a decent sense of Chromebook's web performance.
We also run some Android-based tests on Chromebooks, since they support Android apps as well. Some of those are Geekbench for Android for CPU performance testing, Graphics Bench for graphics, and PCMark Work 3.0 to round things out. Higher scores across these tests mean better performance overall, but they're only useful for comparing Chromebooks to other Chromebooks.
Finally, let's talk about workstations, the powerhouse laptops and desktops. These aren't your typical systems. They come with top-tier processors and enterprise-grade GPUs meant for professionals in fields like 3D design, engineering, and animation.
Now, because workstations are high-performance machines, we run all of our content creation benchmarks like Photoshop, Premiere, DaVinci Resolve, and Blender on these machines, but we also go a step further.
That's where SpecView Perf 2020 comes in. This test measures graphic performance specifically for professional applications like PTC Creo, Autodesk Maya, and SolidWorks. It tests at 1080p resolution and gives us results in frames per second, so higher numbers mean better performance here.
So whether it's Macs, Chromebooks, or mobile workstations, we adjust our testing to make sure we're capturing the full performance picture for each of these unique system types.